Blackstone Audio presents Propaganda by Edward Bernays. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Dedication to my wife, Doris E. Fleischman. Some of the ideas and some of the material in this book have been used in articles written for The Bookman, The Delineator, Advertising and Selling, The Independent, The American Journal of Sociology, and other journals, to whom the author makes grateful acknowledgement. Introduction. 1. Prior to World War I, the word propaganda was little used in English, except by certain social activists and close observers of the Vatican, and back then, propaganda tended not to be the damning term we throw around today. The word had been coined in 1622 when Pope Gregory XV, frightened by the global spread of Protestantism, urgently proposed an addition to the Roman Curia. The Office for the Propagation of the Faith, Congregatio de Propaganda Fide, would supervise the Church's missionary efforts in the New World and elsewhere. They are to take account of and to deal with each and every concern for the spread of the faith throughout the world. Far from denoting lies, half-truths, selective history, or any of the other tricks that we associate with propaganda now, that word meant, at first, the total opposite of such deceptions. Of the sheep now wretchedly straying the world over, Gregory wrote, especially it is to be desired that, inspired by divine grace, they should cease to wander amidst heresies through the unhappy pastures of infidelity, drinking deadly and poisonous water, but be placed in the pasture of the true faith, that they may be gathered together in saving doctrine and be led to the springs of the waters of life. The word seems to have retained its strongly Catholic aura well into the 19th century. And often, when the user stressed that Roman origin, the word would be pejorative. Derived from this celebrated society, the Congregatio de Propaganda Fide, the name propaganda applied in modern political language as a term of reproach to secret associations for the spread of opinions and principles which are viewed by most governments with horror and aversion, writes the British chemist William Thomas Brand in 1842. However, while the word then could be used to make a sinister impression, it did not automatically evoke subversive falsehood, as it has since the 1920s. In his English Traits, 1856, for instance, Emerson uses propagandist as an adjective not at all suggestive of the stealthy spread of some pernicious creed or notion. He describes the British as still aggressive and propagandist, enlarging the dominion of their arts and liberty, a passage that associates propaganda not with alien subversion, but the most enlightened rule. Their laws are hospitable, and slavery does not exist under them. What oppression exists is incidental and temporary. Their success is not sudden or fortunate, but they have maintained constancy and self-equality for many ages. Prior to the war, the word's derogatory use was far less common than its neutral denotation. Here, for example, is the calm and accurate definition given in the Oxford English Dictionary. Any association, systematic scheme, or concerted movement for the propagation of a particular doctrine or practice. Thus was propaganda generally perceived not as an instrument for striking horror and aversion in the souls of government officials, but as an enterprise whose consequences might seem horrid, or innocuous, or even beneficial, depending on its authors and their aim, and the perceiver's point of view. A campaign to improve public health through vaccination, sanitary cooking, or the placement of spittoons was, or is, no less a propaganda drive than any anti-clerical or socialist or nativist crusade. Evidently, this
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.